This week, the precious metal indices tread water while U.S. tech shares added to gains on better-than-expected U.S. employment numbers. Well, welcome back, everyone. Your host, Chris Waltzek, with you on this June 1st episode with another two big guest interviews. Dr. Paul Craig Robert from the Institute of Political Economy, author of several best-selling tomes, rejoins the show, and he has good news for precious metals aficionados. Then Arch Crawford, head of Crawford Perspectives now for 41 consecutive years, rejoins the show with his technical take on gold, silver, shares, and virtually all the markets. He also likes precious metals and perhaps Bitcoin as well, as a hedge against uncertainty. And Robert Ian wraps up the show with his latest must-hear report. The Q&A hotline is open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. You can call in anytime you like, 641-715-3900. Please jot down the number and our mailbox number you'll need, 514049. The number again, 641-715-3900, mailbox number 514049. Goldseek.com radio begins now with a market weather recap. Partly sunny skies appeared over the precious metals sector as investors remained on the sidelines on news that the summit between North Korea and the White House was back on the table. By Friday's close, gold was off just $4, 1%, finishing at $12.99. Silver dropped just one dime, a little over 0.5%, ending at $16.44 an ounce, while the XAU shares were off just 45 cents, closing at $83.04. Black gold gave back $2, 3%, at $67.88, and Bitcoin gave back just a nickel, less than 0.5%, finishing at $12.10. The top story moving the sector this week, data from the Friday morning U.S. jobs report indicated 223,000 new jobs. That was 33,000 more than expected. It knocked unemployment to a new 18-year low, down from 3.9% to 3.8%. This better-than-expected figure will certainly give Fed officials everything they need to raise rates in a couple of weeks, which we certainly see the Fed funds future showing 91% odds of a rate hike. Plus, the solid monthly U.S. employment data sent the dollar to a new peak, though, before dropping sharply on the buy the dollar, sell the news, as investors have obviously already factored in the next quarter point rate hike, slated for approximately June 13th. The last quarter point bump I expect to see this year will be at the December meeting. Once rates, though, are solidly over 2%, the yield curve could invert, which might slow economic conditions and potentially put the greenback under considerable pressure, sending investors into the precious metals. Elsewhere, news that the White House had announced tariffs on steel and aluminum from Canada and Mexico as well as the European Union Friday seemed to put a floor under safe haven assets. In response, Canadian officials announced tariffs on a wide range of U.S. goods by July 1st, while Mexico is implementing steel and food tariffs in response. The EU is expected to announce reprisals on steel and U.S. Harley-Davidson motorcycles, as well as miscellaneous goods, by June 20th. Precious metals, bottom line. Well, the U.S. dollar finally hit stiff resistance this week. The precious metals safe haven investments have held up well during the dollar rally in recent weeks. And that bullish technical pattern is stubbornly resilient. The one from 2009 seems to be forming here. I expect a breakout in gold and silver as soon as this month. Now that dollar strength appears to be weakening, the technical situation suggests as high as $20 to $21 silver and perhaps $1,500 gold sometime between now and the end of the year. Moving on to the Wall Street Report, visibility virtually unlimited over the New York Stock Exchange this week, especially in the tech shares, as lessening geopolitical tensions and robust U.S. economic numbers encouraged investors. By Friday's close, the Dow added 38 points, still holding under 25,000 resistance at 24,753. The S&P 500 picked up 0.3%, finishing at 2734, while the NASDAQ added 120, 1.6%, finishing at 7454. Well, the technology stocks led the rally this week with gains in companies like Apple, Microsoft, Google, and Alphabet, sending the S&P 500 tech sector to new records, plus solid construction spending and industrial production were viewed as solid signs of better growth and corporate profits ahead. And lastly, the U.S. president announced the resumption of plans for the summit with the North Korean leader Kim Jong-un on June 12th. U.S. shares, bottom line. Well, the 7 indicator greed to fear index pendulum is right smack in the neutral category for the 4th week in a row. Again, that leaves plenty of room for upside potential. And if the NASDAQ is any indication, it certainly seems on path to continue this astounding equities bull rally as we've been anticipating now for several years in the Alpha Stocks newsletter. Coming up after the break, more Gold Seek Radio. All right, former Assistant Secretary of the Treasury Economic Policy in the Reagan administration rejoins us today. Also, former editor and columnist for the Wall Street Journal, Business Week. Welcome back, Dr. Paul Craig Roberts.
Thank you, Chris.
Clearly, trade war appears to be on the horizon. Nobody really wants to call it that, but it's not particularly good for anybody. I think you might agree. Obviously, we've let our guard down for a couple of decades here. We need to protect U.S. workers. We need to protect U.S. manufacturers. We need to protect our businesses. But at the same time, you know, that should require careful negotiations. Do you agree with the way this is unfolding, or would you have gone about this a different way?
Well, Chris, my perspective on the matter is totally different from the context in which this problem is described and discussed. The term trade war between the United States and China doesn't apply because half or more of the products coming into the United States from China are the production of American firms. For example, Apple's computers, Nike's sports shoes, Levi's jeans. There are so many American firms who produce the goods and services that they sell to Americans. When these goods come into the United States, these goods and services, they count as imports, and they worsen the trade deficit. But they are, in fact, products of American firms. Put on tariffs, the trade war is between Washington and the American firms, not China. So how did this come about? It came about because of globalism, which is probably the most destructive thing that could possibly have happened to the first world economy. And neoliberal economics have essentially destroyed the manufacturing capability of the United States, England, Italy, France, in fact, all of Europe. Even has seriously impacted Germany. Because what happens is, the firms, pressured by Wall Street and the financial districts to increase their profits, dismissed their first world employees, paid first world wages, and moved their output to countries where wages are substantially lower. And the differences in labor cost, and of course other things, you know, emissions and safety and all that, but it's mainly labor cost driven. That goes into profits and raises executive bonuses and shareholders' capital gains. This sort of trail of the unfair Chinese that we have to put barriers against, we're putting barriers against Apple, Nike, and Levi, and all the rest. Now, why isn't this known? I've been trying to get this across to economists for years. I've written books about it. I've demonstrated it. I've proven it conclusively. It's not even subject to debate. But it remains ignored. Why? Because these economists want to believe that offshoring of production for the home market is free trade, when in fact, it's the direct opposite of free trade. Free trade is based on the principle of comparative advantage. And comparative advantage says that capital finds its most productive use at home, specializes there, and then trades what it produces at home for what other countries specialize in. And what's going on is the reverse. It is the pursuit of absolute advantage, the pursuit of lowest factor costs across international boundaries. And this was ruled out by Adam Smith and Ricardo as free trade. So we have this situation where economists misrepresented the offshoring of goods and services as free trade. They misrepresented globalism as some form of free trade nirvana. And they don't want to admit that free trade, or what they think and said is free trade, and still think is free trade, is harmful. How can free trade be harmful? Everyone benefits. You know the propaganda. You heard it all your life. Free trade benefits both sides. So if the offshoring of goods and services is free trade, then how could anyone be hurt by it? And so what is all this talk about tariffs and protection all about? So the discussion is really so far away from the facts of the case that it makes no sense whatsoever. Now let's take another aspect of it. Trump wants to put tariffs, or did put tariffs, on steel and aluminum coming in from China. Well, what does that do? That's not the way to do tariffs. When you put tariffs on steel and aluminum, which are the inputs into the productive process of American firms that make things out of steel and aluminum, you drive up their prices and make them uncompetitive. The way protectionism is supposed to work is you try to lower the cost of inputs and put the tariffs on, say, manufactured consumer goods from another country, so that, or whatever product that you're trying to protect at home, you don't put it on the inputs into your products. So there's a second total failure of the thinking in this protectionism. So none of it makes any sense. No good can come of it. And until the United States comes to terms with the fact that it sat and let Wall Street drive American firms' production overseas under threat that Wall Street would finance a takeover of the company if they didn't move offshore and increase profits. That's the reason that during a period of intense urban growth, suburban urban growth, decline of rural areas, that all the manufacturing cities in the United States have lost substantial population. St. Louis, Cincinnati, Detroit, you can go on and on. I wrote a book, it's all chapter about it. These people have had population losses from 10, 15 to 20 to 25%. The cities are shrinking. And today, there's a very interesting counterpart to this in Italy. This article has appeared, I suppose, lots of places, but it happens to be on the online journal Strategic Culture Foundation by Attilio Moro. And this is the New Italy. And what is the New Italy? It is city after city after city that used to be top-line designers, manufacturers, the best kinds of quality. They're all now vacant. Factories are gone. They've been moved out to low labor cost countries, some of them in Turkey, for example, other parts of Asia, so that you have what were the premier manufacturing and design cities in Italy are now desolate. So this is available. You can just read it. It's an absolute counterpart to what has happened here. It happened in England, France, and is happening in Germany. You take something like Bosch, say their tools, you know, their battery-driven drills and sawzalls, they're made also in China or Indonesia. So what you see happening, this is the reason now, Chris, for the much-publicized, enormous increase in the distribution of income to the upper 1% and away from the rest of the population. We see the worsening, the continually worsening income distribution, because what is happening is middle class wages and salaries are sacrificed for capital gains for the property owning class. So this is the big problem. And
you've really made it clear that putting tariffs on the input is tantamount to trying to patch the Titanic. I mean, the ship is already going down. They're addressing not only the wrong issues here, but it's a little late. I mean, at this point, there must be some better contingency plans that you have in mind following this gutting, as you call it, of the manufacturing sectors. We've lost something like an astounding number, 500,000 manufacturing jobs per year, amounting to close to 10 million, depending on which tally you follow. Do you think then that this was inevitable, given the information age explosion and the ease of transportation with shipping and things of that nature in the last couple of decades? Or might this have been avoided, and what can we do about it now?
Well, Chris, first of all, the Western economists they couldn't understand that to move the production of your domestic goods offshore, thus depriving the people of the incomes with which to buy the goods, is the antithesis of free trade. So you have a completely incompetent economic class, the people of Harvard, Princeton, Yale, wherever they are. So that made it possible for Wall Street, you know, I'm using that as the shorthand for the investment bankers and so on. They saw the Soviet collapse, and they saw that India and China had changed their economic policy and were willing to accept foreign capital. They saw that meant that India and China had opened their vast, underutilized labor markets to American capital. And so it was completely obvious to Wall Street that the share values of American companies would go up if their profits went up, and that their profits would go up if they moved their production to China or India, in the case of software engineering. And therefore, these higher profits would benefit Wall Street. So Wall Street simply told the firms that were hesitant to go or distrustful of the situation or didn't want to abandon their home communities. I was actually on a global manufacturing board that went through this. They simply said, if you don't move it abroad, we're going to finance a takeover of your company, take it over, and they'll move it abroad. It's just that you won't be the CEO anymore or the executive vice president or the chief financial officer and so on. And that's what happened. So it was greed of the rich for more at the expense of the domestic population. So why did it happen? Because there was no leadership. There was no political leadership this century. It started in the 1990s in any large scale way. And what was Washington doing in the 20th century? It was planning wars all over the Middle East. What we've done in the 21st century is to destroy and hold apart seven or eight countries. We've murdered millions of people, maimed, dispossessed, dislocated. So when you have a government focused on establishing American hegemony in the Middle East and Africa and not paying any attention whatsoever to the real problems, it all happened without notice. Now, I was screaming about it the whole time, but everybody just said, oh, it's free trade. We're benefiting. It's free trade. Well, if we're benefiting, how come now we got to have protectionism? Clearly, we didn't benefit. There's no benefit. All the statistics show there's been essentially no growth in real median family income in decades. So where's the benefit? The benefit goes only to shareholders of the firms that moved abroad. So, yeah, it could have been stopped, but it would have taken leadership. It would have taken governments focus on something besides taking over the world. It would have depended on Wall Street being sufficiently moral not to sell the country out for its short-term profits. Because all these profits are short-term, because what happens when there's no growth in consumer income is there's nothing to drive the economy. And what's the growth record of the entirety of the West, including Japan, for the last 20 years? It's practically zilch. Where's the growth in Europe? Well, look at the unemployment rates, particularly among the youth. Look at them here. So they have to resort to falsifying all the economic data that they tell you. They tell you, oh, we have full employment. We got 3.9% unemployment. Yes, because they don't count the discouraged workers who spent years looking for a job and can't find one and didn't search in the last 4 weeks, and so they're not considered part of the labor force. It's impossible to have the combination of a 3.9% rate of unemployment and a falling labor force participation rate. Anytime you have rising employment, falling rate of unemployment, you have people entering the workforce, not abandoning it. They're entering the workforce to take advantage of the jobs. It's not possible to have full employment and a falling labor force participation rate. Never have had one. So they falsify that. Then they go out and they falsify the measures of inflation. They say there's no inflation. Everybody that buys anything knows there's inflation. You can't go to the supermarket without knowing there's inflation. There's no inflation. Well, why is there no inflation? Because, well, they don't measure it. They change the way they measure inflation. It's no longer a fixed basket of goods. Such that if a price goes up, then the index goes up by the weight of that price, the basket. Instead, if a price goes up, they throw it out of the basket and put something in that's cheaper. Or they say, oh, it's not a price rise, it's a quality improvement. Of course, it is a price rise to the consumer. It absorbs income that's not available for other uses. And so if they understate the inflation, then they overstate the growth, because when the GDP is measured in nominal terms, and so you have to deflate it for the rate of inflation. But if the rate of inflation is understated, then you are counting price rises as GDP. Even though they do that, the GDP growth rate is still very low.
That's what our good friend John Williams from ShadowStats.com has done such an eloquent job outlining, understating the inflation rate. They've actually overstated GDP, and according to his numbers, we've had zero real growth in gross domestic product since as far back as the year 2000. Many of these numbers are unreliable at best.
They're fraudulent in order to hide the fact that globalism is a total failure and has ruined the country, because all the global corporations have a short-term stake in it. It increases the manager's bonuses. It increases the shareholders' capital gains. So the whole thing is a fraud. You see, if we really had economic growth, why would everybody be drowning in debt? You know, even the Federal Reserve has published 41% of the U.S. population cannot raise $400 in cash. You're talking about dirt poor people. The student loan debt is $1,048,000,000,000. That's higher than the credit card debt, I think.
You're right.
So how do you have, and all this indebtedness has grown dramatically in the 21st century. So if there's any economic growth, why is everybody deeper in debt? Because the only way they can maintain their living standard, or the only way they can prevent it from falling faster, is to build up their credit card debt. So you've got people with massive credit card debt who can barely pay the minimum payment. If you only pay the minimum payment, your credit card debt is growing almost exponentially. But as long as you pay the minimum payment, you know, they'll say, okay, you may have $5,000 in credit card debt, and you got to pay $15 a month or $35 a month. So you're not even covering the interest on the existing debt. So it grows and grows. The same thing happens to people with student loans. There was an article recently in the Wall Street Journal about a dentist in California, University of Southern California graduate, private school. His student loan debt is over $1 million. He's making $225,000 a year. He's paying almost $1,600 a month against his student loan, and still the student loan debt is growing by $130 a day. So in another decade, he's going to be $2 million in debt. He and his wife live in a small rented apartment, drive a used car. Michael Hudson talks about how the financialization of the economy has diverted the economic surplus into interest payments on debt. None of this will be part of the discussion. And they'll go on talking about a trade war, which is a totally inappropriate term because the imports are half or more. A few years ago, I looked at this very closely. I don't remember how many years ago, but most likely it's in my book, The Failure of Laissez-Faire Capitalism. I looked very closely at the percentage of goods shipped from China that were the products of American companies. I think something like 54%, 56%. In some of the Chinese coastal cities reported that 67, 70% of the goods shipped out of them were the products of American operations in China. So all of these goods that are driving up the trade deficit, it's not China's unfair competition that's cost the Americans the jobs. It's the American firms moving the jobs to China, and the economics profession and our government can't get their mind around that simple fact. Understand what the situation is, so they talk about trade wars.
And do you suppose, though, that part of the issue there is sort of a groupthink that obviously has emerged from Keynesianism among those Ivy League schools you've talked about? I mean, it's kind of a closed cabal.
It's right-wingism. It's free tradeism. Of course, it's not free trade, but they think it is. And so they're for it. And they think that everybody benefits from free trade.
You'll recall Ross Perot, circa 20, 25 years ago, everyone essentially lambasted him, but he said, you hear that giant sucking sound, look, that's what NAFTA's going to do to all your jobs. Fast forward 2.5 decades later.
Right. And he was right. He was completely right. But again, the economists said, oh, no, it's free trade. It can't hurt. It's free trade. Free trade benefits everybody. They simply don't know what free trade is. They have no idea. Libertarians, for example, mean is free trade is the right of firms to do whatever they want. That's what they mean when it gets right down the bottom line. I mean, I was for years on the libertarian think tank. I know them all. And free trade means the right of a company to do whatever it wants. But that's not what free trade is. Free trade is very precisely defined. And it's not what's happening. Look, the United States, when it was successful, in the post-war years when it was so successful, was based on the simple fact that it didn't have any foreign trade. It was the domestic economy. We had the biggest consumer market in the world, and you didn't need to sell anything abroad. You sold it to Americans, and they were paid well. So they had plenty of money. They bought the stuff. Foreign trade was the Keynesians used to point out over and over. Look, I'm not a Keynesian, but the Keynesians point out over and over, foreign trade is negligible in our balanced trade. And foreign trade never became an issue until our domestic oil wells ran low and we had to start importing oil. And so our main foreign trade item was we imported oil and sold guns and weapons. The United States economy developed on the basis of protected markets. I mean, that's what the so-called Civil War was about. The South said, look, you outvote us now, and you're putting in these tariffs, and we have to pay the tariffs. It benefits your manufacturers, but it hurts our living standards, and it causes the British to retaliate against our agricultural products. So you here you are raising your incomes by lowering ours. That's what the Civil War was about. And so we've had protectionism ever since. And that's how we, and until this 20th century globalism crap, and that's how we developed. Free trade played no role whatsoever in the development of the United States. Michael Hudson's proved this over and over. In fact, when I studied school, everybody knew that. It wasn't an issue of the American GDP that it didn't matter where it existed or didn't.
We were taught the Ricardo model, where everybody benefits through comparative advantage by we focus on maybe wool production, you focus on wine production, and because of our comparative advantages, it lowers the overall costs through global trade. You seem to think that the benefits there are vastly overstated.
In that model, Ricardo and Adam Smith say that in fact, it's cheaper to produce both wine and wool in Portugal. It's cheaper to produce both there. So why don't the British capitalists move their facilities to Portugal and produce there? And the answer they give is, well, they want the protection of their own government. They have a love of their own country, and they don't want to risk their capital in a foreign land. They want it where they can watch it and influence the government to protect it. And so they won't do that. So Adam Smith and Ricardo both assume the British would not, in their example, would not pursue absolute advantage by taking advantage of the fact both wine and wool can be produced cheaper in Portugal. That instead, they would figure out where they had the least absolute advantage, and that would be their comparative advantage. And so they would focus on that, and the assumption is that Portugal would do the same thing. They would figure out where their advantage was greatest. And in the arithmetic example that Ricardo gives, the Portuguese advantage is greatest in wine, and the English advantage is greatest in wool. But still, the Portuguese can produce both cheaper than England, but they can produce wine by a larger factor cheaper than they can produce wool.
And you've made it clear, I think, as well, that the cure, the panacea, should not involve the inputs of goods and the manufacturing process, but actually we have a huge systemic problem where we have offshored a tremendous amount of our manufacturing productivity to nations where labor costs are virtually nil. So is there a solution? I think you've already alluded to part of it, and that is we need politicians and policymakers who have a mindset that involves more than just getting reelected in the next 2 to 4 years. We need a 5 or 10 year or 20 year plan.
We don't have 20 years.
That's a big statement.
We don't have 20 years. People now are so overloaded with debt, it's not clear what they're going to do. What can you do? You see, it's hard to do anything because of the WTO. If Trump puts on tariffs, that's a violation of WTO. They can sue us. They've put in place all kind of legal mechanisms that make it impossible to fix it. So maybe if Trump can pull out of the Iran agreement, he can pull out of the WTO. The only thing that I know of, and I don't think it would be a WTO violation, but who knows, the United States could change the way it taxes corporations. it could tax them. The tax rate could be determined by whether they produce the goods domestically or offshore. And if they produce them domestically, they get a very low tax rate. But if they produce them offshore, they get a very high tax rate, such that you could tax away the gain in profits they get from the lower labor cost abroad. That's what you could do. But you can't do it because the corporations are too powerful. They give all the contributions to the Congress and the president himself, and they'll block it. But theoretically, you could do that. You could simply say, okay, we got a new tax reform. All corporations who produce what they sell to Americans here at home, they have a 5% tax rate. But if they produce in China or India or Indonesia or Turkey or wherever, the goods and services they sell to Americans, they got a 50% tax rate. And that, or whatever it takes to neutralize or more than neutralize the labor gain or the labor cost reduction they get from producing abroad. So you could do that if you could get it passed, because it has taken the high productivity, high value added jobs that made the United States a land of opportunity, that gave it a growing, rising middle class. All those jobs have been given to foreigners. And if you look at the Bureau of Labor Statistics own monthly payroll job reports, what kind of jobs are they? They are low-paid domestic services, non-tradable domestic services, increasingly part-time, ambulatory health care assistants, retail clerks, waitresses, and bartenders.
I mean, you really have your finger on the pulse of not just the working class, but the middle class, gutted beyond belief. I'd say even worse in Great Britain than in the United States. It seems to be headed this way. Do you have any solutions?
Socialism. Washington could nationalize all the firms. Just nationalize them and bring them home. You know, what we know, because of Bush and Cheney and Obama, is the president can declare almost anything. The Constitution doesn't restrain him anymore. He can ignore a habeas corpus and throw you in jail for the rest of your life and never present you to a court. He can order the military to kill you on suspicion alone. So there are no constraints on presidential power. They can spy, which is strictly illegal, without warrants. Can do what they want. So the president could simply nationalize all the offshore factories. He can nationalize Apple and Nike and Levi and all the rest of them. Just nationalize them and order the production restarted here. He could do that. That would be an exercise of power. The corporations misuse of their power. Yeah, that's what could happen. Socialize them. Put all Americans back to work. It doesn't matter.
The elite wouldn't like their plunging share prices, though, would they?
They're a threat to the national security. They are. They are a threat to national security. They're destroying the economy. They're destroying people's lives. They're a worse threat than so-called terrorists, if such a thing even exists.
Well, the founders agreed with you.
Yeah. So, but nothing short of this can be done.
Can you give them some ideas on just what the implications of all this are for their portfolios and how they might better position their families and themselves ahead of what sounds like incredibly challenging times?
Their stock portfolios are based entirely, or the values of them, are based entirely on Federal Reserve money creation for a decade. They're not based on the profits of the companies. I mean, most of these companies, if you know, to the extent they have profits, they've used them to buy their own stock back. I think I read not long ago that something like 95% or more, maybe it was 97% or something, some huge number, percentage, of American corporate profits were used to buy back their own stock. And that some companies even went in debt to buy back their stock. So why are the stock prices up? For two reasons. The companies have bought back their stock, just driving up the price, reducing the supply. And the Fed has been printing money, hand billions of dollars for a decade. And where is that money going? It's going into the prices of financial assets. So the whole thing is a Ponzi scheme. None of these stocks are worth the basis of real fundamentals, what they're selling for. So what blows that up? Something will, sooner or later. The Fed managed to print that money all those years because if the dollar starts falling in exchange value relative to other hard currencies, the Fed simply has their central banks print money too. So who's printing money? The Japanese, the European central banks, they're still doing what's called quantitative easing, the Bank of England. They're all printing money hand over fist, and that then protects the dollar. And my colleague, Dave Krasler, and I have proven conclusively that there's interference in the gold futures market to suppress the price of gold so that it doesn't rise dramatically relative to the dollar. So that's how they keep that going. Well, all that money printed by the Fed, the stock prices would be nothing like what they are.
So is it safe to say precious metals, real estate, at least productive real estate, farmland, might be two safe havens with your scenario?
I can't think of anything else. But you see, there are no safe havens if governments get desperate. They just confiscate.
But is there really a track record of that? I mean, nobody actually...
Well, FDR made you turn in the gold.
They did, but no one was prosecuted.
Turned it in anyhow. Very little of it wasn't turned in. You know, there's just enough of those old gold coins around for collectors to bid up the price, but not enough to run an economy. And, you know, they took the silver out of the currency, and we used to have $1, $5, and I think $2 silver certificates instead of Federal Reserve notes. And they were, I can remember when they were in circulation. But they took all that out in the 60s. Governments can do whatever they can get away with.
The Fed themselves actually showing that less than, I want to say 60-70% of Americans have $400 in savings, and many have much less than that. Given that, how can the everyday American actually insulate themselves from this deluge that you see? I mean, if they don't have any disposable income left, any investment available, you can't even start to consider, can you?
That's right. For the last 20 years or so, the distribution of income has gone from something reasonable to something no one ever would have thought possible in the United States. It is so skewed in favor of the top 1 or 5%. And nobody else has got anything. And just look at who owns the stocks. And then all of this offshoring of the jobs has put all the major cities and states in budget difficulty. And so they can't meet their pension requirements. So all these pension funds are in trouble. I mean, it's Illinois, isn't it? It's, I'm not even sure their bonds, but a junk rating now. I don't remember. But, you know, a powerful industrial manufacturing state like Illinois, and they're busted. And they're busted because the tax base was moved to China. So what pays the pensions? People have just been fed so much propaganda. And, of course, it's even worse, Chris, than anything we've said, because what we've been witnessing since 2014, so about 4 years, is the United States trying to pick a nuclear war with Russia and China. That's what you need to worry about, because if you ain't here, you don't have to worry about whether you got any money or not. And nobody pays any attention to that.
Two of the only countries that have actually gone back to much of the success, the blueprint of the United States 100, 120 years ago, clearly China's game plan, protectionism, economic growth and manufacturing, focus on the industry instead of on all these little petty regulations and infighting among different cliques and cadres. Why don't you leave folks with some final thoughts?
And everything we said, it's now going to be worse because of robotics.
That's an interesting one. We've been following very closely here for a year.
So the robots buy cars and clothes and entertainment and houses and furniture? No. So if everything's made by robots, what happens to consumer demand?
The real story there, of course, is artificial intelligence, as I'm sure you know. We've already seen over in Japan, we've talked about this a lot on the show, top insurance jobs being replaced, saving the company millions of dollars per year, but outsourcing 20 or 30 key folks in the insurance company simply with a single IBM artificial intelligence machine. And this is a growing theme where I think the folks who thought they were insulated from it, the intellectual, the accountants, lawyers, we may see those white-collar jobs for the first time under attack, under assault from AI and robots, as you refer to it.
Well, keep in mind, Chris, what artificial intelligence is limited to is what you can program into a machine. These machines don't think independently. And so it's really not artificial intelligence. It's just something that you can program. These are not machines that are capable of sitting down and making discoveries and coming up with a theory of relativity or inventing some new product.
I agree with you on one level. The only problem is now what we're seeing is, and this is befuddling scientists across the board, they're rewiring themselves. Here's an example. I'm sure you've read they're using artificial intelligence to help diagnose cancer, tumors, and things of that nature at something like a 98% proficiency relative to their human cohorts, which are somewhere between 60 and 80%. So even the experts are deferring now to AI, and they're actually rewiring themselves. The programmers cannot understand the conclusions that are being drawn, the inferences. This is where I think we're very close to crossing Kurzweil's, you know, AI singularity. But you know what? That is really another topic for another day. But it sounds like people need to be preparing. Is that the takeaway?
Well, you can prepare for a year or so, however much freeze-dried or other kinds of long shelf life food you can afford to accumulate, whatever coins, silver or gold that might be useful in transactions, and firearms and ammunition and training that you can protect what you have. You can do that, and that works, you know, for a while. But things fall apart. You can't replace those supplies as you use them up. And this is what identity politics does. It turns the population against itself. And so when you have a population that's lost in its own divisions, frees the government or whoever the ruling elite are that are using the government. So it's even worse than you say. I mean, what you said is true, but it's worse because there's no longer any way of a unified people standing against an elite.
And that really is the battle, isn't it? The 250-year battle that we've been up against, that our founders warned us about. And it was going on long before the Constitution and the Bill of Rights were ever in place. And as you might recall, it's kind of a tired cliche now, but Benjamin Franklin, you know, what have you brought us, Benjamin? A republic, if you can keep it.
We've been losing it consistently, beginning with the so-called Civil War.
So we have all the links up to Paul Craig Roberts. Maybe give people an idea of the books that you've penned, what they can find when we put those links up.
The best short economics text they can read on our dire situation is my little book, The Failure of Laissez-Faire Capitalism. It's recent. And then the other two recent ones are How America Was Lost, The Neoconservative Threat to World Order. Those are the recent ones, but on my website, all the books are listed and described. I thank you, Chris.
My featured guest today, Arch Crawford, combines technical analysis, finds patterns that others miss. Arch Crawford has been doing this at Crawford Perspectives for over 40 years. Welcome, Arch Crawford.
Well, thank you very much. As a matter of fact, in 2 days, it'll be 41.
41 years. Incredible. You know, in previous discussions, you have talked about Al Bielek. You actually attended one of his sermons
at a psychotronics group in New York City, when he and the other fellow who survived came to that meeting that I was speaking. I didn't remember that when he came and stayed with a friend of mine. I didn't remember it until later that I had already met him. He knew my friend here.
The reason I ask is that it would further corroborate his difficult-to-comprehend stories. A Philadelphia experiment, that's right. So it must have been the USS Philadelphia destroyer. He actually started to delve into MKUltra. You know, mind control, Project Monarch, Project Artichoke, Project Paperclip.
Tell you a bit more about what he said. He was working in the highest levels of the government, mathematics and physics, and that he saw three different alien species working in the same place much later.
Okay, because they say, all right, Arch, tell us what you see in the market.
Well, they're breaking down right now in the last hour. Short term, I was looking for a low, well, June 1st, Friday, open strong week in the afternoon, May 28, 29, which is another week. Sun-Mars-Pluto combination in declination, likely hostile, possibly explosive, plus the full moon. Watch out for this day. I think it's the 29th, the 28th and 29th. June 6th, well, I would like to say the June 6th, it says, I see, a really mean day, hostility, death, Sun-Moon-Mercury-Uranus-Neptune combination. And what I found is that the more planets involved in a combination, the more powerful and more exacting is it. So that's June 6th. Devastating news into option expiration June 14th, 15th. 33rd is honorary, and they invite you, and their office is in Washington. And I think if there's anything about controlling politics, it's from the 33rd degree. And I've met close to, I don't know, I was going around with my master was the district deputy grand master of a district in New York, and I went around with him, and I met maybe close to 1,000 Masons. And if any of them knew underhanded things that are claimed by some people, I would have only met two or three who might even have known that, but we didn't discuss it.
There's a lot of misinformation out there.
The Masons are on the regular level of the lodge, and even the state organizations are very fine and very philosophical and very uplifting. The other most important date I have is for a low in the metals and inflation hedges generally on the 25th, which is this coming Friday from when we're recording this. There's a Jupiter trine to Neptune. When we had one in 2001, my newsletter went long on gold, and it was like 248 or 252, around in the 250 area. And I held it for several years, most of the time for the next several years, while it went up and up and up and up. That was the waxing trine, however, and this one is the waning trine. But I expect the same thing to happen on at least the short term, and maybe the long term, maybe not. But I'm a buyer of the metals, and maybe even Bitcoin and any kind of hedge to the normal situations as of the 25th.
Given the dollar strength, we've had, what, three or four explosive weeks in the U.S. dollar in close to a month of upward strength. Can you resolve that divergence?
Well, specifically on the dollar index, rallied from 89 to 94, and its momentum has been slipping in the last week and a half to the point where a MACD sell was rendered about 5 or 6 trading days ago, although the price has continued higher. Those signals are often early. It just means that the momentum is slowing on the MACD. So I would say yesterday's action had a new high in the dollar index and came back and closed lower, which means that may be the technical sell signal, 350. Which is just a bit under the high of 90, almost 94, I think it was 93.65 was the high.
You know, the U.S. equities rally has to be still one of the most hated and disbelieved. In fact, if we look at the market data, the Almanac, I mean, this is one of the longest continuous rallies in U.S. stock market history, over 120 years.
There's another way to look at things right now, and that is that this has been the longest longest period of time where we have not made a new high since 09. The high was, of course, late January, the 26th, I believe. The SPX, the DJI, the NDX, the major indices.
You know, one of our guests, Martin Armstrong of the Forecaster, he has been one of the few to remain very bullish for very different reasons than a lot of our guests. He's cited capital flows, funds into the United States.
The tax change that Trump put through, very, very positive for corporations and for bringing money back here. And that may be why we had such a rally in the dollar index.
And you're not terribly perturbed by potential trade war as well as the continuing saga there between North Korea and the West?
Well, we don't know how that's going to work out. It goes back and forth, and I don't think it's going to be meaningful in terms of the market.
Do you see any signs that would cause you to feel that there might be something ominous for the United States or for the financial markets?
Oh, yes, absolutely. You mentioned Saturn. Well, Saturn is coming up to Pluto, January 2000. Depression kinds of periods in the past. The chart of the United States in a very long time, I don't really do charts of individual people and things very often. I usually look at the transiting aspects in the sky and where they have important degrees in a map of the world. I would say right now I'm concerned about the Ring of Fire.
Exactly right. Kilauea, Hawaii, there's been quite a volcanic eruption, unlike we've seen since, I think you'd say, 65. So far, there hasn't been any loss of life, but an awful lot of loss of homes, more expected.
Well, some of the scientists are worried about California. There's been an increase in the smaller earthquakes there. But I don't know, I have not looked into detail on that, and I don't know if it's enough to be seriously worried, or just they're saying that they think California might be next.
There was another article. Seismologists and geologists had identified disturbingly high levels of seismic activity in Yellowstone National Park, and there's the big Calderon, I believe they call it.
There have been unusual goings on there. I have not followed the ones lately, but they're not that far from California. They're not really mid-country. Mid-country ones are along the Mississippi.
Madras Fault, the Mississippi, actually ran upriver for quite some time. As I understood, it leveled many cities along that fault, but there weren't many major cities like the San Francisco quake, and I think because it was so long ago before...
Solar storms, they had the telegraph, and it was setting fire to things at the end of the, you know, where they go, did starting fires. But that was September of 1859, I think.
Anything you'd like to leave with the listeners on the general markets? You know, to make people's portfolios a little happier.
Well, I'm still concerned about the long term. I mean, we've been going up a very long time. And I agree with Martin that the money is pouring back here right now, and I don't know how long that will last, if it'll be all over in a few weeks or if it'll last 5 years.
So you think this might strike like lightning in the night?
Well, I'm very concerned about next year in 2020, about long-term bottoms in the market in 2020, 2021.
It's close to coinciding with Bitcoin billionaire and Silicon Valley venture wizard. He is looking for Bitcoin 250,000 by 2022, and he called the 10,000 Bitcoin from 500. He expects it to be the future, period.
We shall see. I didn't start really following it closely until November, December, and I said in December there are a couple of dates, the 2nd and the 17th, that look for highs in all kinds of different markets, whether you're doing stock, individual stocks or stock groups or bonds or currencies or commodities. But those two dates were indicative of short-term tops in various markets. The 17th was, I didn't realize it was on a Sunday when I wrote it. That Sunday was the exact top in Bitcoin.
With any bubble, think back to the tulip mania, think back to the dot-com days. It's in the mystery that perpetuates the bubble. I mean, the blockchain is here to stay. It's going to change the world. Does it go to 100 or 200,000 or even a million before it pops? You want to tell people more, please, about Crawford Perspective?
41st year, 2 days from this recording, we have some of the best records in the business, being number one market timer for several different periods since we've been publishing. And to reach it, it's crawfordperspectives@earthlink.net, or just Google Arch Crawford. That'll be the first or second one to come up is the website. And you can sign up on the website, or you can call the office. We like you to send a check. And that's Crawford Perspective. That's the email. And the phone number is 520-577-1158.
All right, Arch, we appreciate your thoughts.
Thank you very much.
This is Robert Ian with GoldSeek.com Radio. A Wall Street Journal story about a dentist with over $1 million in student loans has received significant coverage this week across talk radio and from various policy institutions. The basics of this story discuss how a dental school graduate borrowed just over $600,000 for graduate school and living expenses, and how that debt has now grown to over $1 million through the magic of compound interest working against you. And even though he is now on a 25-year government repayment plan at 7.25% interest, the debt will never actually be repaid, and will in fact grow to over $2 million over the life of the loan, at which point it will be forgiven, even though he will have paid in $1.6 million in payments at that point. The debt forgiveness in 25 years, at today's tax rates, could cost the dentist another $700,000 in income tax payments. There's so much that's wrong with this story, at so many different levels, that it would take 4 or 5 commentaries to effectively address all the intertwined issues. From overpriced universities to why interest rates on graduate loans were so high compared to 2 and 3% interest rates elsewhere in the economy during that same period, to the assumption that one can actually plan economically for the next 25 years, to the modern financial concept of indentured servitude, to an IRS that may still be lurking at the end of the 25-year repayment plan to pile on more debt in the form of taxation, to the idea that most student debt can no longer be discharged in bankruptcy. But one comment by the dentist's wife in the Wall Street Journal article said in part that the dentist and his wife concluded dental school was a good investment given the salary he expected to earn. She said, "We can make this work. There are certain things that are okay to go in debt for, like a house, an education, a car. But let's stop right there and examine those beliefs. Those very beliefs may have been the standard their parents adhered to in very different economic times, with costs and debt levels significantly lower. But given today's economic volatility and massive global debt levels, is that really sound advice? For $600,000 in tuition costs, one might have hoped some kind of economic education might have been included at the prestigious university this gentleman attended. But hoping doesn't make it so, and wouldn't necessarily be in the university's interest to create awareness and possibly doubt about the future economic viability of what they are selling, which is, in essence, a kind of Ponzi scheme, when debt is easy to get and hard to pay off. The casualty in all of this is time and freedom. What if, God forbid, the dentist or his wife have a change in their health situation down the road? What if his industry changes? What if he decides he doesn't like dentistry and wants to do something else with his life? Debt of that magnitude and under those terms limits choices and opportunities. Spend your time, your freedom, and your life wisely. And until next time, this is Robert Ian with ConquerChange.com. Thanks, Chris.
Okay, Robert, thanks for another excellent installment. Well, that wraps up this week's GoldSeek.com radio episode. For two new big guests, be sure to check out next week's show. Until we talk to you again, have a great week.